slide here. I think this is the, is this the Bitcoin network?
Yeah. So this is what Bitcoin is. This is actually a cut-down version of some of the core central main miners. Now, that's a mesh. A mesh is this sort of spoken hub model where things join and go through many hops. Bitcoin is near complete. And for the miners, what you end up with is practically every single miner connected to every other miner. The distance in the network is about 1.32.
So it doesn't mean the miners are in the middle there?
No, they're on the outside.
These are the miners.
And that's these are all the connections between the miners. So when people talk about network theory, one of the things that people have gotten wrong, because there are not a lot of mathematicians in Bitcoin at the moment, contrary to what people try and tell you. There are not a lot of cryptographers. There are a lot of people who call themselves applied cryptographers and things like this. They're not actually cryptographers. Some people like Matthew Green and whatever else are real ones, and then there's lots of pseudo ones. What we have is we have vertices and edges, and the number of nodes is not important. How many nodes you have in network theory is irrelevant. It is how much connectivity you have between nodes. If you have a node with sort of a couple connections between each, the number of vertices and edges and whatever.
Is that Lightning? Yeah. Lightning network?
That's or Lightning.
Proposed
yes.
Lightning.
Proposed Lightning. So if you have a small number of connections between each of the nodes, that actually means it is less densely connected. The number of connections between the devices is how you determine how decentralized a device is within network theory.
So I guess these are the three main sort of questions this talk has to hopefully come across as answering is, what is the current capacity problem with Bitcoin?
That's very simple. We have an arbitrary cap that was set way back a number of years ago in 2010. Where the network has scaled, basically Moore's law has scaled over 100 times since then. The amount of storage capacity has increased by 250 times. The smallest computer used on the Bitcoin network in 2009, the smallest system, is bigger than many of the so-called UASF nodes that people are trying to run. There was nothing that small back then. So we've gone backwards. We've got this arbitrary thing that we need to run it on smaller and smaller computers because there are people out there in the world who can't afford big computers. But you can't make the argument that someone who earns $2 a day needs to run their own node. If that person earning $2 a day has to pay $3, sometimes $4 fees, they're not going to use Bitcoin. It's like saying, if you're earning $1,000 a day, will you spend $2,000 in fees? Because it's valuable. It's valuable because it adds value. Now, if you look at Coca-Cola, they sell a very simple product. It is cheap, and they make a lot of money. Not because they sell expensive Coke, but because they sell a lot of it. And that's how we should be thinking about Bitcoin. Lots of little transactions will actually earn far more for miners.
So I think that kind of summarizes this slide, but and we forgot to redact some of these specific company names there, but what is that picture up there? I was kind of confused on
So one of the things people try and argue is Bitcoin is anti-bank. It isn't. It's not central bank focused. It is not anti-bank at all. Banks are not depositories. People who argue that Bitcoin is anti-bank do not understand the first aspect of banking. Banking is about matching. It is about finding your money and someone in need. It is about matching that. Now, banking is going to change. The whole industry is going to change. In the next 20 years, the amount of disruption and redistribution of what's out there is going to be phenomenal. None of us will recognize the world in 20 years as we do now. If you start thinking 1 billion times the computational power in a chip, and you think about what that really means, it changes everything. And that changes banking too. When you start thinking about a distributed system and people starting to be able to match and do things in a peer manner, the nature of banks will change. When the Rothschilds in the 18th century set up what became one of the most successful banking industries and families for 200 years, they did it because of technology. They were able to get, they had a better distribution network and were able to get information faster than anyone else. They had basically rioters and all sorts of things that would send information across Europe.
I remember that. I remember that story. They made a lot of money because they were the first ones to know that Napoleon lost at Waterloo.
Exactly.
And then they lied and they told that Napoleon won, and then they bet against the Bank of England, the gilts, the treasury bond, something like that.
They had a Pony Express form of transport that managed to get information one day quicker than everyone else. So they bought up bonds and they sold things and they won on the market because of that. It was technology. And again, those who embrace technology will win. It's always the way. Technology grows and changes, and those who reject it eventually find themselves left out of the market.
I'm glad you say Bitcoin is not anti-bank, because SBI has a bank. We are very much in the banking financial services industry, and we very much also like to use Bitcoin. So it is not anti-bank.
Think about it for a minute. It's not going to, because you have Bitcoin, change the nature of what people are like. We still want homes. That means home loans. We're not going to move away from credit anytime soon. And because you have Bitcoin, doesn't mean that you can no longer buy things on credit or ahead. If you have Christmas shopping you want to do, how about if you want to start a company and you want to go out there and raise funds? ICOs aren't sort of the future, and that's not going to be how everything happens. People will still need to raise capital. People will still want to have investments. People will still want to just splurge and have a credit card they can pay off. It's not always a bad thing. Some people get into trouble, but that doesn't mean you sort of throw out the system. Now, what we need to do is start creating systems that deal with how people interact. Not try and change the world to fit our views, but to give the general people and the general population what they require.
So when I looked at this slide, I was kind of confused at the network speed. Was that like bandwidth?
That's bandwidth at the moment. So, we've got what people talk about as being a projected speed for the networks, which people argue Moore's Law, and that's really the Moore's Law growth. Except what we've actually been seeing and what we're seeing is actually double Moore's Law. So we've actually seen the amount of fiber, the amount of everything being laid, networks are growing faster than Moore's Law by a factor of 2. So we have, for instance, 4G, 5G, rollouts happening, and some of these are becoming phenomenally fast.
Okay, so what could Bitcoin do? I mean, I think you pretty much jumped ahead and said a lot of the things that what Bitcoin could do if it scales to the full potential already. So how are we going to scale to, what is that, 50 trillion users or gigabytes?
No, this is talking about other options. In the future, we're looking at embedded systems, machine to machine. It's not just people anymore. A ledger doesn't need to be communication between you and I buying things from a shop. The nature of money will change. We have a world that is going to start interacting between people and machines, machines and other agents, machines and machines. And once that starts happening and they start communicating, they will start actually grabbing information and data and actually trading themselves. As we get smarter agents, smarter bots, smarter machines, artificial intelligence will go to where we start seeing machines communicating and acting on our webs, not just in sort of fast trading networks and like derivative trading or anything like this, but everyone. How do you buy your power, your water, your everything else? How do you start doing all of that? How do you manage your data in your life? How do you pick the best experiences? Agents and machines will start doing us those favors. And that's where we'll start growing all of this. Computation is about energy and economics, as it says there. Computation is what's growing. And as it grows, the economics of the world grow. We are in a phenomenal golden age. Everyone loves to say how terrible things are in the world. We have the least number of poor people in poverty. Poverty is no longer because we don't have food. It is because of political concerns. When I was a child, I grew up and heard about famines in China, famines in Africa, famines everywhere because of a lack of food or poverty. Now, we don't have that. It is a distribution problem now. It is corrupt governments. In the West, our idea of poverty is someone has an Xbox and their own home and only one car, etc., and they're poor. If you think sharecroppers 100 years ago, it was a big thing for a sharecropper to finally get a Model T, and only a few people in a community would have that. They wouldn't have electricity, they wouldn't have phones, they didn't have a washing machine. Now all those things aren't even luxuries. We just assume that that's what anyone will have.
It's actually kind of interesting that you say, you mentioned it's a distribution problem, because I've actually thought a lot of that myself, and whenever I argue with the people who are more interested in proof of stake cryptocurrencies, because they have a thing about wasting energy, mining, but I believe that mining is one of the most purely fair economical ways to solve the problem of distribution. Because how do you distribute money to everybody in the world? Well, you could just give everybody in the world like 10 coins, but is that fair? I mean, is that a really good, that very, very communistic way of thinking of it, but is that the most efficient way to distribute coins? So the way Bitcoin does it is that it incentivizes people who can efficiently produce electricity more coins. They're the ones who get to decide who to give coins to. And what better way to incentivize people or companies to invest in efficient electricity production? How better to incentivize fusion power, solar panels in space, than to make it monetarily, economically viable to invest in these technologies than to mine Bitcoin? If it wasn't for Bitcoin mining, maybe we'll never get fusion power, if we get fusion power. So I think proof of stake is missing the point. The distribution problem should be solved by the smart minds on planet Earth who can benefit economically by solving these problems, which would make life on planet Earth a lot better for everybody. So,
do you know the biggest problem with fusion power?
No, I don't. I'm not a fusion scientist. But the fact that nobody wants to fund it.
No, actually it's not. It is actually computation. What you're doing is trying to have a toroidal ring. Now, won't try and explain the mathematics of this, but think of a big donut. So you've got a mathematically controlled donut, and any particle can actually make that collapse. So you've got to do hundreds of trillions of calculations a second to redo the power to keep this toroidal ring in the correct shape. We don't know how to do it because we can't run that sort of power. big computers try and they fall over. They make a little tiny thing that stays for 20 seconds and we go, wow. We're here and our computation is increasing.
Now what is that chart?
This is a chart of power by cost. And we see from 1900 and we're increasing.
Computational
power, what we have on systems at the moment. And we're up here getting, we're sort of at dog level. We passed cat and we're now at the equivalent AI-wise as dog, so around here. which then monkey and humans, and who knows?
So our computers are as good as a monkey right now.
No, not quite a monkey. They're somewhere between monkey and mouse. So our best supercomputers are between monkey and mouse. But in a few years' time, even the problems of calculating how to keep a torus in shape will be simple. Because in 20 years' time, we'll have a smartwatch that can do that calculation. Just like now, you have a smartwatch or an Apple Watch if you have one that can send a person to the moon calculation-wise. In fact, it's something like 1 million times the power of all the systems that they used to send the first person to the moon. So that's where we've got to. And we don't even think about it now. I mean, it might be for Angry Birds or whatever else, but if we actually used it for other things, there's a lot we can do.
So what is this whole Turing complete diagram up there?
So most people don't understand that Bitcoin is actually Turing complete. We've got a number of papers coming out in just a week or two. I'm not sure what the time frame is. Jimmy can explain that. But they're about to be published. We've put a few things up, and some other people that are out there have held off publishing until we finish some of ours. And thank you to those. But Bitcoin is different to many systems. It is a dual-stack system, and it's a total Turing machine. Now, it's a decider. In the main automata book by Sipsa, which is the fundamental textbook that most people learn automata theory on to start, the entirety of the description of a decider is one paragraph. Because Bitcoin is the first decider.
Okay, so I do program, but I'm not computer science-y enough to know what a Turing decider is. So if you can sort of, what would be the ramifications of this being available in Bitcoin? Does it mean things like rootstock or Ethereum, smart contracts? Is all that doable on Bitcoin? Should we do it?
I need to think small. A language such as Haskell or Wolfram's language is a simple one. Could be imported directly into Bitcoin. And effectively, anything you can calculate is calculable. In a single transaction at the moment, which is why we're developing SDKs to make it simple, because they're very complex right now, your total output space is 2^2^160, which is effectively infinite. Not infinite if you're a mathematician, but if you imagine 2 raised to the 2^160, basically you have enough computational space for every particle in this universe, not the galaxy, universe, to have that many states as the entire universe, again, per particle. And you'd still be able to calculate more.
But wouldn't that still mean that if we were to use Bitcoin as a calculation agent, wouldn't that mean that we would get one state transition every 10 minutes?
No, actually. One of the things people don't understand, if you take the logic format by Gödel and his predicate logic system, what that means is you settle per 10-minute time. But you can also chain transactions. Now, there are ways of doing that without some of the losses that people talk about. But the main thing is it allows for parallel computation. You only care about truth. You don't care about a false state. So if you have a specialist node that actually takes any false states and rejects them, you have a true state that gets settled in the network. So if you have, say, 1 billion computations going on simultaneously and only one of them works out correctly, that's the one that gets settled.
Okay. I'm going to admit that I still didn't absorb most of that, but I will concede that it's something that is I'll have to look into deeper. What's the paper?
The way to put it would be it's near infinitely parallel.
Okay. All right, so this, I believe, is one of the things that Bitcoin could do or could do because of that, or just never done?
No, this was actually there. The early Bitcoin code, and all of this has been removed, included a product database. It used WXHTML, which is probably the awfulest whatever web front end, but And you can do horrible looking web pages like that. But, I mean, I won't say anything because I'm not a UI designer. I can do back-end stuff, but that's about as pretty as I can design a front-end. It's got colors there.
Is this like a point-of-sale terminal in Bitcoin? Or
exactly. The IP to IP functionality allowed people to do reviews, allowed people to set up eBay-type sites, allowed people to have subnodes. So you could have your mining nodes and then nodes that did specialist functions like computation that then would send to the network based on selected input variables. So something new. Now, IP to IP actually is more than IP to IP. It could be near field to IP. One of the keys there is people have to stop thinking that it's important for you to send your transaction. If you go into a shop, you go to a merchant, you don't care that your transaction is sent. The merchant cares. If I hand over money and I tap on my phone and I sign a transaction and the merchant now has my signed transaction, I don't care that they don't validate it. I really don't. If I go in and pay for my meal at a restaurant and hand over the money and walk out and they have a network error and their machines crash and they don't get my payment, I really don't care. Might sound mean and nasty, but it's not my business to make sure that the restaurant or the shop takes my money. The merchant does. So when I'm doing a transaction like this, I don't need to connect to the node. I don't need to validate my transaction. The merchant needs to validate the transaction. The merchant cares about being paid. I don't care if they get paid.
So the merchant is the one that should pay for a validating node.
Yes.
Okay. So this is the projected growth of the IoT, Internet of Things, and how does this affect Bitcoin? How does Bitcoin potentially affect this?
As we start increasing over time, we see we've got more and more things happening. There are lots of weird devices, and one of the things I like about Japan is there's always weird devices popping up. People will try things. A number of years ago, I found a internet-connected noodle strainer. So you plug it in, and you could get your noodles strained before you got home. I haven't actually managed to find a real use for it, but I bought it because, well, I like strange Japanese gadgets. There are toothbrushes now that are wireless and connected and all this stuff. Coffee machines have been around for years, fridges for years, but everything else. I mean, I've got a internet-connected door. So the doorbell will buzz me anywhere in the world. I can see the people there, talk to them, as long as the network connectivity is okay. But everything you can think about is starting to be connected. And over time, these devices are going to need to pay for themselves. When we want to start hiring smart cars, in a few years' time, Uber and Google and Ford and Tesla are going to be coming out with self-driving vehicles. That's going to change so many things, it's not funny. The nature of transport will change. And to do that, well, why do I need to have a car if I can just have one come? Or if I own a car, why do I want to put it in a parking lot? I can let other people use it. I can start doing this sort of thing. I own a car, I drive to work, why pay £50 in London to sit in a parking lot and do nothing when I can just let it go out there and earn money for me? So in the future, I'm going to want devices that can earn money for me. If I invest in actually owning equipment, why shouldn't it pay me back?
Okay, so moving along, so here are like about 10 minutes left. What are some important things that maybe you've seen about Bitcoin? What are some myths? I see where this is an SPV, simple payment verification wallet. So what's wrong with that? Or what's a myth about that? What do people not know about SPVs?
They're not doing it right. This idea that everything needs to be perfectly validated and checked. We can actually look at using survival risk models and randomly test data. Now, that means pulling not even full blocks, but random transactions. we can go to a block that has been mined and check the hash rates of individual parts of a transaction and do that from a number of miners and validate that everything adds up and is all the same.
So just so people who don't know, like SPV wallet is a wallet that doesn't store the whole blockchain?
That's correct. Okay. But once you, even if you have a enhanced SPV where you still validate yourself, you don't need to keep storing. If you think about it, once you have the hash of a block, you never need to recheck that. As long as the hash matches, you know 10 years down the track that that block is correct. And if you've checked it once, you don't need to do it 100 times. So this is some of the other problem people are doing. They check, and they check, and they check. Even with full wallets out there, why do you need to keep all that information forever? If you have checked once, it's valid forever.
So yeah, it has ramifications for like I guess point of sale systems, merchants. These are kind of like potential candidates for SPV wallets. If SPV was enhanced to do this sort of Bayesian probabilistic checking of nodes of transactions and blocks, it wouldn't need to actually store the whole blockchain themselves.
And that's an important aspect here. Not everyone is equal. Not everyone needs to run the same network. At the moment, one of the arguments. People like your thing there.
Or like the election system, right? So you have random nodes randomly checking bits of the
blockchain. You need to check everything. If you randomly check 100 votes and they turn out perfect, do you keep going? If you go out to Price Waterhouse or Ernst & Young or something like that, they do not check everything on your system. They come and they randomly audit. And as long as they find no problems, that's it. That's all they need to do.
Right, that's what auditors do.